A blessed morning to all of you who are worshiping with us on this first day of November, the 22nd Lord's Day after Pentecost. Please have your pen or pencil, notebook or paper, your Bibles and your hymn books, and of course, receptive hearts as you prepare to meet with the risen Savior, our Lord Jesus Christ.
When I look into your holiness, when I gaze into your loveliness, when all things that surround become shadows in the light of you, when I found the joy of reaching your heart, when my will becomes enthroned in your love, when all things that surround become shadows in the light of you, I worship you, I worship you.
The call to worship. When we stand at the edge of fear and worry, God invites us to step into the waters of faith and trust. When we stand at the edge of the world's pain and need, Jesus invites us to step into the land of humble service. When we stand at the edge of our hunger and thirst, the Spirit invites us to sit at the table of grace. we sing our opening hymn, number 113 in the Voices in Praise, When Morning Gilds the Sky. Go to God in prayer as I invite Sister Kanisha George to lead us in the prayer of adoration and Sister Katisha Venture in the prayer of confession.
Almighty God, we adore you for who you are. We adore you because you are holy. You are set apart for you alone. We adore you because you are self-existing. You are the source of all things. You do not need anything from anyone. Instead, we need everything from you. You are the great I am. We adore you because you are just. Deuteronomy 32 verse 4 says, "You are just in all your ways." Your justice is of great comfort to believers living in an unjust world. We adore you because you are love. You are loving in all your ways. Your love is so deep that we will never reach its bottom. We adore you because you are powerful. You are so powerful that you simply speak this world and all that is in it into existence. We adore you because you are truth. There is no deceit in you. All that you promise comes to pass. All that you say is right. We adore you because you are beautiful. The glory of your presence makes it impossible for anyone to stand before you. Father, we give you all the honor and praise this morning. You are indeed deserving of them. Bless your holy and mighty name. Amen.
Prayer of Confession. Merciful Father, you created us in your own image, Lord. You know our thoughts before we act on them. You x-ray our hearts and see through our excuses and intentions. Your Spirit warns us, but sometimes we ignore you and fall victim to sin. So today we are confessing our desperate need for your forgiveness. You have promised that if we will confess our sins, you will forgive us and make us clean again. Lord, we truly need your forgiveness. Repentance is on our hearts and lips. We want to turn around and head another direction back to you. But we need your help, Lord. So hear us, Lord, as we individually confess to you. Father, we thank you for hearing our prayers and for granting of pardon. In restoring us, teach us how to say no to things that could harm us, others, or our testimonies. Amen.
We continue in prayer, the call to reconciliation. We know how easy it is to do exactly the opposite of what we learn from our teacher, Jesus. So let us draw near to our God, for in confessing our failures, we will discover the grace and mercy God has in store for us. Join me as we pray, saying together the prayer for forgiveness. When we come to the edge of your holiness, constant love, we know how we have not lived as your children. We dam up for ourselves your rivers of love, while the lives around us turn into deserts of loneliness. All too quickly, we place our feet on the quicksand of fear, not wanting to step across to your faith. We tie up our angers and worries and burden our families and friends with them. Forgive us, listener to our hearts. By your patient grace, give us more time to practice our calling to discipleship, so we might learn all we need to live as sisters and brothers of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The assurance of pardon. This is the good news. God hears you. God forgives you. God is with you as you journey into that land called promise. Let the redeemed of God say, "This is indeed great news." Accepting God's words of joy and grace, we will live as God's children in all the days to come. Amen. We now sing the hymn 245 in the Voices in Praise through all the changing scenes of life.
Oh,
I now invite the steward on duty, Sister Donna Luzanne, to bring us words of welcome.
We greet you in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. All Saints Day is a time to rejoice in all those who have gone through the years. Today reminds us that we are a part of one continuous company of saints. It is time that we claim our kingship with the glorious company of the apostles. We welcome Reverend Prescott, our superintendent minister, who will be bringing the message this morning. Our worship leader, Reverend Greta St. Hill, who will be leading us in this service. And to you, all our friends out there in virtual land, we welcome you. May God continue to bless you, and may this worship service be an act of blessing and motivation to you all. Circuit notice for Sunday, November the 1st, 2020. A special greetings extended to all those celebrating birthdays and anniversary during the course of the week. We pray that God will continue to enrich you in your relationship with Him and in your lives. Baptism Alive this week will be done by Sister Anastine Alexander, and it will be aired on GBN 105.5 FM at approximately 5:40 a.m. on Wednesday. There will be a special meeting on Tuesday the 3rd for the members of the Constantine congregation at 2 p.m. Missionary Sunday commences on the 15th to the Friday the 19th November. Guava Sunday, November the 15th at 4 p.m. St. George's Monday the 16th at 7 p.m. Constantine Tuesday, November the 17th at 7 p.m. Woburn Wednesday, November the 18th at 7 p.m. Grenville and St. James Thursday, November the 19th at 7 p.m. Bethel Friday, November the 20th at 7 p.m. Congregations are reminded to report on their missionary project at their respective missionary meeting. May God continue to bless you this week as we continue to give Him thanks and praise for His many blessings. I want to thank all those who have made this service possible, and as you go into this week, remember to pray for each other and to support each other in our different communities. May God bless you richly.
We turn our attention to the ministry of the word. Let us say the collect together. Almighty God, increase in us your gift of faith, that, forsaking what lies behind and reaching out to that which is before, we may run the way of your commandments and win the crown of everlasting joy. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. The Old Testament reading is taken from Joshua chapter 3, verses 7 to 17. This will be read to us by Sister Sherilyn Mitchell. And the Gospel reading will be read to us by Sister Kalisha Brooks. And it is taken from Matthew chapter 23, verses 1 to 12.
The scripture reading is taken from Joshua chapter 3, reading verses 7 to 17. The Lord said to Joshua, "This day I will begin to exhort you in the sight of all Israel, so that they may know that I will be with you as I was with Moses. You are the one who shall command the priests who bears the Ark of the Covenant. When you come to the edge of the water of the Jordan, you shall stand still in the Jordan." Joshua then said to the Israelites, "Draw near and hear the word of the Lord your God." Joshua said, "By this you shall know that among you is the living God, who without fail will draw out from before you the Canaanite, Hittite, Hivite, Perizzite, Girgashite, Amorite, and Jebusite. The ark of the covenant of the Lord of all the earth is going to pass before you into the Jordan. So now select 12 men from the tribe of Israel, one from each tribe. When the soles of the feet of the priests who bear the acts of the Lord of all the earth, rest in the waters of the Jordan. The waters of the Jordan flowing from above shall be cut off. They shall stand in a single heap. When the people set out from their tent to cross over the Jordan, the priests bearing the Ark of the Covenant were in front of the people. Now the Jordan overflowed all its bank throughout the time of harvest. So when those who bore the ark had come to Jordan, and the feet of the priests bearing the ark were dipped in the edge of the water flowing from above stood still, rising up in a single heap, far off at Adam, the city that is beside Zerahem, while those flowing towards the Sea of Arabah, the Dead Sea, were wholly cut off. Then the people crossed over opposite Jericho, while all Israel were crossing over on dry land. The priests who bore the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord stood on dry ground in the middle of the Jordan until the entire nation finished crossing over the Jordan. This is the word of the Lord.
The gospel reading is taken from Matthew 23, verses 1 to 12. Then Jesus said to the crowds and to his disciples, "The scribes and the Pharisees sit on Moses' seat. Therefore, do whatever they teach you and follow it, but do not do as they do, for they do not practice what they teach. They tie up heavy burdens hard to bear and lay them on the shoulders of others, but they themselves are unwilling to lift a finger to move them. They do all their deeds to be seen by others, for they make their phylacteries broad and their fringes long. They love to have the place of honor at the banquets and the best seats in the synagogues, and to be greeted with respect in all marketplaces, and to have people call them rabbi. But you are not to be called rabbi, for you have one teacher, and you are all students. And call no one your father on earth, for you have one father, the one in heaven. Nor are you to be called instructors, for you have one instructor, the Messiah. The greatest among you will be your servant. All who exalt themselves will be humbled, and all who humble themselves will be exalted." This is the gospel of Christ.
I now invite Reverend Silbert Prescott to deliver the message that God has laid upon his heart.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. I greet you all in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It is my pleasure and joy to join you as we gather once again for worship on this, the first Sunday in November, the 22nd Lord's Day after Pentecost, in the 31st week of ordinary time. This morning, I would like to share with you from the book of Joshua, the Old Testament reading for this morning, Joshua chapter 3, reading from verse 15 and 16. It reads, "Now the Jordan overflows at its banks through the time of harvest. So when those who bore the ark had come to the Jordan, and the feet of the priest bearing the ark were dipped into the edge of the water, the water flowing from above stood still. Pray. Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks for our time of worship this morning. We give you thanks for the ways in which you would have ministered to us through song, through prayers, and through the various ways in which we would have engaged each other in worship and fellowship today. Now that we are about to hear your spoken word, we ask, O God, that you will speak through this your servant and speak to me, and may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. My message this morning is entitled, Trust in God in Seasons of Transition. Trust in God in Seasons of Transition. Change is part of our everyday experience. It is something that we experience in every facet of life. Whether it is a change that comes on with age, the change that occurs as part of the seasons of life, or a change to our situation and circumstance that we experience on a daily basis. Change is inevitable, and depending on how we navigate these changes, they can become fruitful fields of our growth and development. Friends, today's Old Testament passage from Joshua chapter 3, verse 1 to 7 is a passage about change. It is, in a sense, the continuation of a story about Israel, a story which we have been looking at for the past several weeks. But at the same time, it features a brand new beginning for God's people. It is a story about the Israelites who had just emerged from the wilderness in which they were traveling for the last 40 years. And they are now crossing over into the Jordan, or through the Jordan, into the land which God had promised their forefathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. It is the second crossing over story of the Israelites, and is often overlooked because it has often been overshadowed by the miraculous story of the crossing of the Red Sea. However, these stories function as kind of beginnings and endings, both of which features an incident where God divides water so that the Israelites can cross over on dry land. In the first incident, the Israelites are escaping from slavery in Egypt and have been catapulted into the wilderness, where they experience tremendous struggles in their feet as they wandered around from one place to another. In today's story, they are about to cross from the wilderness to the promised land. And just as God parted the sea for them to make their first crossing from slavery to the wilderness, here again, God parts the River Jordan so that they can cross over into the promised land. Just as the Exodus began with the crossing at the Red Sea, the Exodus ends with the crossing of the River Jordan. And in this sense, it is a critical part of the story of Exodus because it ends one chapter of the life of the people of Israel and it begins another. This chapter of Israel's history began with Moses and the plagues and Pharaoh's army being drowned in the sea. And it comes to a close with the crossing of the Jordan as they move to occupy the promised land. It is a nation-altering and a nation-forming event. And as such, I believe that One could look at it as one of two events which summarizes the Exodus, the wilderness journey between those two bodies of water. As the crossing of the Red Sea was the beginning for the children of Israel, so the crossing of the Jordan is a prelude to a totally new chapter in the history of God's people. As the Red Sea washed away the identity of Israel as a nation of slaves, so the Jordan waters washed away their identity as homeless wanderers. As the crossing of the Red Sea, God was shown as the God who liberates. So in the crossing of the Jordan, God is revealed as a God who provides, and provides richly. Friends, both of these incidents capture in a very powerful way the nature and character of God. And so, in today's story, a great deal of emphasis is placed on the priests standing in the middle of the river, holding the Ark of the Covenant. We are told that they went ahead of the people, and as soon as their feet touched the waters of the Jordan, the waters stopped flowing so that the people can cross over on dry ground. Here, the Israelites receive a new beginning, a new crossing, a new mighty act of God experienced, where the chaos of the waters that threatened them became a passage through which God can lead them to God's promised land. You see, brothers and sisters, the Ark of the Covenant represents to the Israelites the very presence of God among them. It was believed that God was enthroned on the top of the ark in a very special and unique way. Friends, as we reflect on this story, there are several things which we can draw important lessons from. However, there are two things which I would like to highlight for us today, both of which has to do with the role that God plays in times of transition and change. The first has to do with water. You see, at both ends of the story, there is water. And in both cases, the water begins as an obstacle, something that stands between the Israelites and the destination to which they are moving. The water represents a challenge to their journey. However, through the intervention of God, the water becomes a path for them to get to their destination safely. In the story of the Red Sea, God transforms the water to be a source of protection from the Egyptian army. The water becomes a symbol by which the Israelites are liberated from a life of slavery. As they pass through the waters, their identity is transformed from being slaves to the Egyptians to becoming the people of God. You see, brothers and sisters, in life and in ministry, we can always have occasions which mark moments of transitions for us. Occasions of birth and death, comings and goings, loss and gain, grief and joy. And we can also find events which don't just mark endings, but new beginnings for each and every one of us. You see, friends, our baptism, the moments where we step through the Jordan waters, the waters which in which Jesus himself was baptized, are moments of such newness, where God does a new work in each and every one of us. and where through which we are propelled to move forward in our relationship with God, where God gives us a fresh new chapter to write, to live, to begin the journey of making our new and freshly washed identity as children of God. Brothers and sisters, when we are baptized, we are made aware of the transforming force in our own life. And in today's story, God transformed the homeless wanderers into a nation that will settle into a new land that they are going to call home. God's work of transition, brothers and sisters, is seen in the water. As the people passed through the water, Israel left behind their old lives of slavery and misery. They were set free from judgment and destruction as they went through the water over the other side. As they passed through, they were able to experience and rejoice in new life, which is in Christ. They became a new people, a new community, and took on a new identity as people of God. Indeed, brothers and sisters, as the scriptures remind us, behold what manner of love the Father has given unto us, that each of us can be called the children of God. It is as we pass through the waters of baptism, whether as children or adults, that we become a new people in God, washed in the blood of Jesus Christ. The second thing I would like to highlight is how, in today's passage, is how the Ark of the Covenant represents God standing and holding back the waters that had the potential to destroy the people as they passed through. Today, brothers and sisters, the Jordan River does not represent the threat that it used to be among the ancient people in the time of Joshua. In fact, verse 15 of this passage suggests that at this time of year, when the Israelites are crossing, was harvest time, a time of the year when the river will overflow its banks. And in other words, at this time of crossing, the river will be at its most dangerous, because the water will be at its highest and at its fiercest levels. The water will be rushing down with all its mighty force. And it is at this time that God literally intervenes and holds back the chaos of the river so that the people can cross over. Brothers and sisters, in time when transition is most challenging, God steps in to ensure a safe passage for God's people to navigate the challenges and the difficulties of life. Brothers and sisters, in our own life and experience, we are constantly facing times of transition in our lives. And these transitions can be overwhelming and sometimes terrifying. Now, these times of transition can take many forms, like picking up the pieces and starting again after the loss of a loved one. It might be turning over a new page or starting over after a very difficult and tragic experience in our life. This year, this time of year might be considered as a time when all Grenadians will recall some of their most challenging periods of transition, like the events of October 19 to 24. 5th, 1983, or the period after September 2004 in the aftermath of Hurricane Ivan. And even now, as we continue to grapple with the effects of the coronavirus, all these experiences can be for us new times of transition. And the truth is, friends, there is always risk. There are always going to be risk when we experience times of change in our lives. But if we place our trust in God as we go through these experiences, God will help to hold back the things that will make it difficult for us to endure. Indeed, brothers and sisters, we will do well to remember God's words spoken through the prophet Isaiah when he says, "When you go through the waters, they will not overwhelm you. And when you pass through the fire, you will not be burned." Brothers and sisters, as we think of the story, I want to invite you to imagine what it would have been like to be one of the Israelites who had to pass in front of this vast wall of water. I would imagine that the Israelites would have experienced at least a little bit of fear that it would all come crashing down on them. It took a great deal of trust and vulnerability to cross the river as they did. And it takes a great deal of trust and vulnerability and courage on our part to believe that God will hold back the waters which we find difficult to cope with on our own and in our own experience. So that, brothers and sisters, as we experience the challenges of life, even in the midst of fears and difficulties, we can continue to trust God. Brothers and sisters, I am not sure what kind of difficulties and challenges that you might be facing at this present time. But no matter what we face, we can continue to trust this God, who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. As we go through a new week with new experiences, let us continue to trust in the God who always finds a safe path through which his people can cross the difficulties. Yes, brothers and sisters, God moves in a mysterious way. His wonders to perform. He plants his footsteps in the sea and he rides upon the storm. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
We thank Reverend Prescott for bringing God's message to us. Our response to that message is, "Swing low, sweet chariot."
Swing low,
swing low,
sweet chariot,
coming for to carry me home.
Swing low, sweet chariot,
coming for to carry me.
Sweet chariot,
coming for to carry me home.
At this time, I invite the head of your household to collect your tithes and offerings for the work of the Lord. Let us go to God in prayer. We offer our gifts in gratitude, Holy One, for all your blessings in our lives. Use them to touch the lives of all who stand on the edge of hope, of peace, of community, that they might step into these promises of yours with confidence. In Jesus' name, Amen. Me to page 73 of the Methodist Prayer Book as we go to the prayers of intercessions. The Lord be with you and also with you. Let us pray. Remember, O Lord, your whole church throughout the world and continually enrich it with the gifts of the Holy Spirit, that in faith and unity we may constantly be renewed by the Holy Spirit for witness and service. Look with compassion upon the peoples of the world and give wisdom and grace to their leaders, that they may promote justice, freedom, and peace for all. Remember also, in your mercy, our own country of Grenada and all who are in positions of authority and influence. In particular, Dr. Keith Mitchell, our Prime Minister, and Dame Cecile LaGrenade, our Governor General, that they may serve with wisdom, honesty, and compassion.
Remember, O Lord, in your mercy, Galbraith, Bishop of our connection, Richards, Bishop of our district, our ministers, preachers, visitors, teachers, leaders, counselors, and officers, and all others who bear responsibilities among us, that they may continually be renewed in faith and have in them the mind that was in Christ Jesus.
Remember, O Lord, the children and young people of this congregation, and especially those who, at this time, may be receiving instructions in preparation for confirmation, that by your grace, they may grow in wisdom and in the knowledge and love of God. Give wisdom and grace to all teachers and students in our institutions of learning, that among them true knowledge may increase and our future as a people may be safeguarded. Remember, O Lord, in your mercy, all those of our society who are unemployed, all who are overworked, those whose work is not appreciated, those who do not like the work they do, or who work under undue strain and temptation, that they may receive the gift of faith to cope with the present and the patience of hope to strive for a better future. Send your blessing, O Lord, upon our families and fill our homes with love and peace, that we may have in this present life a foretaste of the life to come. Remember also in your mercy those of our fellowship who are in trouble, anxiety, sickness, grief, or any kind of need, in particular the Eared family who is at this time mourning the loss of their loved one, Carol. Relieve the oppressed, support the neglected, and recall to yourself those who have erred and strayed from your way. And so increase in us the spirit of compassion and care, that we may be ministers in your name for their recovery and relief. O God, in whom we are one family, in earth and heaven, we now call to mind those who have died, giving thanks also for those who have revealed to us your grace in Christ Jesus. Help us to follow the example of your saints in light and bring us with them into the fullness of your eternal joy, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord's Prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now, O Father, mindful of the love that brought us once for all on Calvary's tree, and having with us him that pleads above, we here pray forth to thee, that only offering perfect in thine eyes, the one true pure immortal sacrifice, as we prepare for the sacrament of the Lord's Supper, let us sing the communion hymn number 420 in the Voices in Praise. And now, O Father, mindful of the love.
Thank you. Let us give thanks to God for the care fund offering. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for the many gifts that you have given to us, for the opportunity to care for those who are less fortunate than us. And as we come in this time and moment, we ask, O God, your blessings on these offerings that we have collected, that they may be used, O God, in the care of those that are needy among us. So we ask your blessings upon these gifts. Enrich us, O God, with wisdom, that we might use them to the betterment of those who need them most, and to the building up of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I invite you to turn with me to page 76 in your prayer books as we begin with the order for the sacrament of the Lord's Supper at the Thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and fitting so to do.
It is a good and pleasant thing, joyful and salutary, always and everywhere to give you thanks and praise. Lord God, ever living, ever blessed, almighty, all loving, to Jesus Christ, your only Son, our Lord, you created all things and made us in your own image. And when we had fallen into sin, you gave him to be our Savior. He shared our human nature and lived a fully human life. He suffered rejection and condemnation and died on the cross. And you raised him up from the dead. And you exalted him to the glory of your right hand, where he reigns forever as priest and king, and makes intercessions for us. In witness of his glory and honor, you poured out the Holy Spirit, building up many people into one body and making us living members of your whole church, and enabling us to stand before you, to sing your praises and to celebrate your mighty acts. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we join in the hymn of everlasting praise. Holy, 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 holy Lord,
of hosts, heaven and earth
are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed are you, Lord God, King of the universe. And blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread into his holy hands, and looking up to heaven, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this and eat it. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant that was poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me.
Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again.
Therefore, Father, in obedience to his command, we do this in remembrance of him, praying that you will accept our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Grant that by the power of the Holy Spirit, we who receive your gifts of bread and wine may share in the body and blood of Christ and become united with him. And as we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice, we pray that you will bring us with your whole creation to this your heavenly kingdom. This we pray through Jesus Christ our Lord,
to whom with you, O Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory from all who dwell on earth and in heaven, throughout the ages of ages. Amen.
The bread we break is a sharing in the body of Christ.
Amen.
The cup of blessing which we bless is a sharing in the blood of Christ.
Amen. Though we are many, we are one body, because we share in the one loaf and partake of the same drink.
Let us pray together the prayer of humble access. Lord, we come to your table, trusting in your mercy and not in any goodness of our own. We are not worthy even to get up the crumbs from under your table, but it is your nature always to have mercy, and on that we depend. So feed us with the body and blood of Jesus Christ, your Son, that we may forever live in him and he in us.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, the table of the Lord is an open table. Children and adults alike, Methodists and non-Methodists, may all participate and share in the sacrament. This table is indeed the Lord's table, where all are invited to come and share.
Go ahead.
I invite the most senior member of each household to distribute the elements as we prepare to receive them. The body of Christ, broken for you, to preserve you to life eternal. Take and eat in remembrance that Christ's body was broken for you, and feed on him in your heart by faith, with thanksgiving. Amen. The blood of Christ was shed for us, to preserve us to life eternal. So take and drink in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for you, and feed on him in your heart by faith, and be thankful. Amen.
Dismiss.
In the power and presence of our risen Lord, we invite you to go now and serve. As you continue to read, as you continue to pray, as you continue to fellowship with the one who died for you. Go in peace, and may God's peace go with you. Amen. I trust that we have all received the elements, and that we are now renewed and enriched as we continue to commit our lives to God. Let us share together in a prayer of thanksgiving. We thank you, Lord, that you have fed us in the sacrament, united us with Christ, and given us a foretaste of this heavenly banquet prepared for all mankind.
Amen.
God bless you.
Will your anchor hold in the storms of life, when the clouds unfold their wings of strife, when the strong ties lift and the cables strain? Will your anchor drift or firm remain? We have an anchor that keeps the soul steadfast and sure while the billows roll, fastened to the rock which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's love. We bring this act of worship to a close by singing the hymn 344 in the Voices in Praise. Will your anchor hold?
Thank you.
Beloved, I trust that this service had been an inspiration to you. So, go forth as God's people into the world. We will go to serve those who stand at the edges of life. Go forth as sisters and brothers of Jesus. We will go to teach the world the ways of peace and hope. Go forth as those filled with the Spirit. We will go to share our lives with everyone we meet.
Please receive the benediction. Now the peace of God, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, with the blood of the eternal covenant, make you perfect in every good thing to do his will, working in you that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory and honor forever and ever. Amen. Have a good day, and may God be with you all this week. Amen.